Are they off?
Not now.
I had to tell all the preachers, turn theirs off, so. Praise God for the presence of the Spirit of the living God in this place tonight.
Amen.
We've come together to share in the Word of God and worship. But we come with a purpose, a specific purpose. That is to address the issue in our county of backsliders in heart. As pastors, we observe our own congregations and the ministries that are within our county, and we recognize in many cases that folks who come to church every Sunday are backslidden in heart because their hearts are cold, they're just coming out of habit, and the Lord really desires for their hearts to be turned towards Him. And our county is filled with disappointed people, people who once filled sanctuaries, but now they're filling other places besides the sanctuary, turning their backs on God and upon the church. And as pastors, we believe we need to speak to that issue. And that's what we're here to do tonight. Pastor John Walls is going to give us a message on backsliders in heart. And we're going to have a testimony by Brother Aaron Anderson, pastor of one of the churches here in town, of what happened in his life and how God turned him around and called him to the place where he is. So we need to address the issue of backsliders. And that is not a very common term these days. We're too polite to use biblical terms sometimes.
Amen.
But that's exactly what our situation is in many cases. So we're depending upon those of you who are here tonight to receive this message into your heart and into your spirit, and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you about your own relationship to God, and then for you to take a look around the landscape of your sphere of influence, your friends and your family. Take a look and see those who have gone away from God, those whose hearts are cold and who aren't attending church anywhere. And we're asking you to pray for them. As a matter of fact, when you came in tonight, we're trusting that everyone received one of these. It's a little wristband that has 2 Chronicles 7:14 on it for you to pray for a revival. And we know that we need to repent of sin and all of those issues, and this is just a little reminder for us to do that. You also received a bulletin. On the back of that are 4 prayer meetings that are going to occur in this month and next month. And our heart is this, that we're praying for the entire county, not just Kokomo. And so we're having prayer meetings in the 4 quadrants of the city of Kokomo, representative of the entire county. And you'll see that on Monday, June the 18th, a week from tomorrow, there's a prayer meeting at Brookside Free Methodist. The 25th at Straight Gate Ministries in the Northeast. July the 2nd is Fresh Start Ministries in the Northwest Quadrant. And then July 16th, New Beginnings Christian Fellowship, which is a North American Baptist church that Pastor Jeff Russell is at. So we're asking you to bring your list of those folks that you have a burden for, that you care about, that you love, that you want to pray something into their heart. You come to those prayer meetings. Doesn't have to be in the specific quadrant you live in or are representative of. You can come to any of them. They'll last about an hour each, and we're just going to pray for our county. Because how many churches are there in this county?
One.
There's one church in Howard County, and that's the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, represented in many congregations, but there's only one body of Christ.
Amen.
This evening, also after our service, we're going to have fellowship. There's cookies, and Pastor John told me cookies and drinks. I thought he said cookies and grits. I've never quite had that combination, but that would be all right. So we're just asking you tonight to open your hearts to the working of God's Spirit. Let Him do what He desires. Will you stand with me, please? Our Father, we thank You for the privilege of being in this place. We thank You, Heavenly Father, for these folks who've come tonight to hear the Word of God and to receive it into their spirit and into their mind and allow that Word to shape and transform their souls and to make them be prayer warriors out of the desire of their heart to love their friends and neighbors to the point that they'll go to extra lengths and great measures to see them come into the kingdom of God. I thank You for the worship team tonight, Father. I pray Your blessing upon them and on our fellowship together as we share in this meeting. We ask Your blessing in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand and keep remain standing for this this particular song.
Yes, as you are able, let's stand and let's lift our voices together and praise the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, and let this prayer be a prayer of revival.
Set me up, please, you know, Jesus.
You may be seated. Brother Logan told me you have 8 to 10 minutes. Everybody in my church knows I can't preach less than 45. And, hallelujah. Well, it's a great honor and a privilege to be here tonight. And I tell you, I love your pal. I love Pastor Walls. Give him a hand clap.
Amen.
That's a great man of God. That's a great man of God. I thank God that in the last few months that God's brought a lot of these men and pastors into my life. And I tell you, God's, for me to stand here tonight, God's got a sense of humor. And where do I start? I grew up in Florida, in a little town in Florida called Palmetto, Florida. Anybody ever heard of Palmetto, Florida?
Yeah.
Oh, they're gone. And I grew up in Palmetto, Florida, and in Palmetto, Florida, when you get to be about 10 years old, you start smoking pot because everybody smokes pot. And so I started smoking dope, I don't know, 9, 10 years old. And listen, I didn't grow up on the wrong side of the tracks. I just grew up with parents that didn't pay attention. They had to work 2 jobs apiece to make ends meet, and they didn't have time to pay attention. And so my friends and my family, my extended family, my cousins, they paid attention to me, getting me high and getting me drunk and all of that. So by the time I was 16 years old, I was pretty much burnt out. At 16 years old, I had done about anything and everything you can think of. I was pretty strung out on dope, and my mom got saved. She gave her life to Jesus when I was about 9 years old. And we all thought she got involved in a cult and she was nuts and she needed to go live in a hospital somewhere. And so by the time I was 16, I was pretty depressed. I was suicidal. I was messed up and had no purpose. Everybody asked me, used to ask me in high school, what are you going to do when you grow up? I'm going to get high. That's all I knew I was going to do. I knew every day I was going to get high somewhere. We lived to get high every day. And so then my dad worked at Delco here. When I grew up in Florida, when I was 13 years old, we moved up here. My dad went to work for Delco, and he retired from Delco. And then by the time I was 16, he got laid off, and we moved back to Florida. When we moved back to Florida, it was a rule in my house that I had to go to church every Sunday morning. I went kicking and screaming, yelling and fighting, I was going to church no matter what. Didn't matter if I come in at 2 o'clock that morning, I was going to church Sunday morning. And so that's just what it was. Either go to church or leave my house. It was one of the two. And so I decided to go to church because living on the street just didn't sound fun. And so at 16, we moved back to Florida. My mom started going to this Assembly of God church. Anytime that I went to church, I went because at least there was a pretty girl that went there. And there was. I found a pretty girl there. And I never met anybody like this girl. She was 16 years old, and I asked her out on a date just to go see a movie, and she said she couldn't do it. She said, I can't do it. I'm going to give my life to Jesus, and Jesus is going to bring somebody young in my life. And come to find out, by the time she was 18, she was married, still married today. It's probably been 26, 27 years later. She's still married. And then my dad got called back to Delco. You got to hear all of this in order to get to where I backslid. So we moved back to Indiana. By the time I was March, April, I just turned 17 years old. And my dad got his job back to Delco, and we moved back up here. Down here, or at least where I was, there was no young people like what I was around. And the church, I come from a youth group that those young people, when we got together, they didn't want to play games, they wanted to pray. I thought that was weird. When we got together at high school, we wanted to party. But they wanted to pray. And they wanted to read the Bible. And they wanted to talk about God. And that was, it made me hungry for God. And then I moved up here, and the church that my mom was going to, they weren't like that. It was more about popcorn and games and all of that kind of stuff. And they really, the young people just, I never met a teenager up in Indiana when I was a teenager. I never met a teenager that knew God.
Come on.
I just didn't. You may have, but I didn't. I didn't know a teenager in Peru, Indiana, when I was 17 years old that knew God. And all of my friends, so I went to church, and those who did go to church, they were just playing some kind of game. They'd act real one way in church, and you go to school, and they're just as high as I am. I'm meeting them at the party on Friday night, and we're getting high, So the church, they wouldn't disciple me. They didn't take interest in me. And because they didn't take interest in me, my old smoking dope buddies did. And I remember I was 17 years old that summer of 83. The summer of 83, I'm older than I look. I'm actually 46 years old and got three kids. I got a 20-year-old, glory to God. I got an 18-year-old that graduated from high school on Friday. Yeah, hallelujah. I got one more. And so I remember it was the summer of 1983. I remember my friends that I used to party with, they told me to come, let's go swimming. So, and I was the only one that had a car, so we was riding out to Missinawal Dam from Peru. And I remember they lit a joint up in my car. And I was depressed. I couldn't find anybody that wanted to serve God with me. And so I remember driving out to Missinawal. I remember smoking that joint with them. I never experienced what I experienced in that car. I didn't really understand how clean and how right I was until I wasn't anymore. And I remember the guilt and the condemnation that came with that. I remember all I could do is just wish I could just leave and get back home or crawl in a hole. And from that moment, that summer, I started school, and then in November of 1983, me and a friend of mine decided to quit school and move back to Florida. By this time, I was into dope again, getting high, but I was miserable. I remember, man, I would lay on my bed at night and ask God, God, I want to serve you. I wanted to serve God. There's some of you here tonight, you want to serve God, but you've fallen back into that hole, and you just don't know how to get out of it. And that's where I was. I was in the midst of that hole again. And I remember I would wake up in the middle of the night, and the first thing come to my mind was that I couldn't believe I was back in the same mess that I just got out of. And here I am, I'm wasting away, and found myself back in Florida and living in Pompano Beach with my two cousins. And now I've gotten into harder drugs. Now I'm snorting cocaine up my nose. I'm staying drunk about every night. I'm getting, after work, I quit school, and after work, I'd come home from work, grab a Michelob beer, pack of cigarettes, get my cousin's car, go to the beach, and sit on the beach and stare out over the beach and think, why, how in the world did I get back here again? How in the world did this happen to me? And I would cry out to God, God, if you really loved me. I remember on that beach, God, if you really did love me, then you would kill me and get me out of here. Because I was miserable. I was miserable, you know. And I would lay down on that couch at night. My bed was in the couch, on the couch. And I would lay down on that bed and I'd cry myself to sleep. And in my heart, I would cry, oh God, I want to serve you. I don't know what to do. I don't know how. I'm telling you, you got children in here tonight that they're backslidden, they walked with God one time. I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost don't ever let them go. I'm telling you, I don't care how deep the hole, how black the darkness, God will never let them go. And in the midst of that, God began to deal with me. And I began to, man, I wanted to get out. I remember I was miserable, I was angry, I was bitter. And I was mad at myself because I felt like I failed God. But I found out I can't fail God. I was never holding Him up.
Right.
Amen.
That's right.
He held me up.
That's right.
And I remember one night, my mom, she was going, at the time she was going to Family Worship Center. She had Pastor Bradley. He called me twice in the midst of all of that. I can't remember what he ever said to me, but I do remember that there was a pastor that took enough time to call me and show me that he loved me. Yeah. And I remember one night, it was about 12 o'clock, I'm almost done. 2 minutes.
Keep it going.
I remember it was 12 o'clock at night. And I had gotten into a meeting before I backslid when I was 16 years old. And I had experienced something in that meeting that it really birthed a hunger in me. I wanted to know God the way I saw this man of God know God. And that never left me. Even in the midst of doing the dope, in the midst of whatever else I was into, I'm telling you, there wasn't a moment, a second, a minute, an hour of every day that I didn't feel the tug of God on my heart. I just didn't know how to get out of it. I didn't know how to make the decision and get out of it. One night, 12:30 at night, my cousins, they always thought it was fun to keep me up snorting cocaine and get me up at 5:30 in the morning to go to work. 12:30 at night, one night, we were sitting around a table, and it was me and my two cousins and these two girls, friends of theirs. And I had a $5 bill. Now, I know this is a little extreme, but this is my story. This is, I can't deny what happened to me. And because what happened to me on that night is why I'm standing here today. And I remember 12:30 at night, I had a $5 bill rolled up and I leaned over to do a line of cocaine. And I heard a voice. I can't tell you If it was audible, if it was inside of me, all I know, it was so loud it drowned out everything else in my life. And I heard these words in the midst of doing a lot of cocaine. I heard this word. I heard these words. What are you doing here? Don't you know that I have something so much better for you?
Amen.
And I thought, and I looked around. I thought, did they hear that? And I heard it. What are you doing here? Don't you know that I have something so much better for you? And the next night, I remember taking my one of those girls to the airport in West Palm Beach. And coming back at about 12 o'clock at night that night, me and this girl got to talking, come to find out she's a backslidden Pentecostal. And I was backslidden. We got to talking about God. And them words are haunting me. I can't get away from them. And for some reason, I don't know how I knew it, but I knew it was God. And I knew that I had to make a change. And I got to talking to this girl coming back from West Palm Beach. And come to find out, she backslid, and her mom and dad, they're serving God and all this. And I turned to her and I said, I don't know what it's going to take. I said, but I'm going to leave this place and I'm going to go to Houston, Texas. And everybody that I know can die and go to hell if they want to, but I'm not going to hell with them. And I turned back from West Palm to Pompano Beach. I told him, I said, I'm not going to hell. And a week later, I was sitting in Delray Beach with my real father that I never knew. And my grandfather, my family. And they got sitting around there, and I told them, they said, what are you going to do, Aaron? I said, I'm going to Houston, Texas. I preached my first sermon in that condo that night, that afternoon. I told them, I'm going to go to Houston, Texas, and I'm going to serve God. And I said, I don't know much about Jesus. I don't know much about God. All I know is at 12:30 at night one night, something happened to me, and I can't do what I've been doing because I'm a miserable individual.
Amen.
And I said, and I looked at them all, my family. I said, you can die and go to hell if you want to, but I'm not going to go with you. I said, I do know this about God. I said, I know that I'm going to die one day, and I'm going to stand before the Lord Jesus, and I'm going to give an account for my life. I'm not going to give an account for your life. I'm not going to give an account for your life. I'm not going to give an account. I went just around the room. I'm not going to give an account for your life. I'm going to give an account for my life, and I'm going to go, and I'm going to go serve Jesus. My real dad looked at me, and he said, you're going to go to Houston, Texas, and that city's going to eat you alive. I said, well, if I die, at least I know where I'm going.
Amen.
And I tell you what, 2 weeks after I heard that voice, I paid off all my bills that I owed. I owed a light bill, phone bill. I paid off my bills, and I got on a plane, and I went to Houston, Texas with $20 in my pocket. It was June or July of 1984, and I got on a plane. I landed in Houston, Texas with $20 in my pocket, and walked off the airplane, gave it to my brother-in-law, and 26, 27 years later, I left Houston, Texas with a family. I left Houston with a ministry, and God sent me to Kokomo to plant a church. I'm telling you that prayer works. I'm a testimony of my mom. You know, my mom, she used to get her Bible and show me. She said, here, Aaron, let me show you what God told me about you. And I think you're nuts. But I tell you, but it changed me. It did something for me.
Yeah.
And my mom, I'm a product of my, you know, for those of you maybe sitting here and you're backslidden, I know where you're at. I've been there. I know exactly what's going through your mind. I know the hell and the condemnation and the guilt that you feel. I want you to know that Jesus, one thing I learned about God in the midst of it, that Jesus never stood there and pointed his finger at me. He always extended his arms to me.
Amen.
And all I had to do was take a half a step towards him, and he leaped towards me.
Yes.
And I tell you, from that moment to this moment, my life has never been the same.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm telling you, Jesus is alive. Amen. And God is real. And I'm telling you, he has turned my life around. Called me to the ministry, which is, you just got to laugh. I mean, you just got to laugh that God would call me to the ministry to minister to people. You know, if you're a parent here and you got people that are backslidden, you got family members. You know, the Bible says in Luke chapter 18 that men must always pray and not give up, not faint.
Right.
Don't quit. Don't quit. Keep praying. Speak the word to them. Love them. You know, my mom never condemned me in the midst of that. We'd come home high. We'd come home drunk. And she never condemned me. She'd always tell me, Aaron, I love you. And Jesus loves you and got a plan for your life.
Amen.
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 That's my story.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm sticking to it.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
We know that God is always there to welcome him back. Jesus, right. His arms are outstretched.
Yes. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
So let's ask that he take our life and we give it to him, to give it to Jesus Christ. As you're able, would you stand and praise God with us?
Thank you.
of God's love. Yes. Strengthen our hearts. Let us be changed and renewed by the power of His love.
Verses 11 through 31, a scripture that all of you probably know very well. It's the story of the prodigal son. Jesus said there was a man who had two sons, and the younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out, go back to my father, and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him, and he was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' The father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast to celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing, so he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back, safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him, but he answered and said, 'Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him.' 'My son,' the father said, 'you're always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' This is the word of God for the people of God." Amen. 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 You may be seated.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm going to tell you tonight that the reason I'm going to preach this sermon is to try to help every believer that's in this place have a fire built in your heart for the lost who are around you.
Amen.
For your lost children, your lost brothers and sisters, your lost neighbors, your lost co-workers. It's my prayer that the Spirit of God is going to move on this place, and He's going to give us a greater burden for the lost.
Amen.
Now, I'm sure that probably most of you know the great promise in Jeremiah 29:11. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." How many of you know that? How many of you have claimed that and said, I'm going to ask God to work that out in my life? Well, I want you to know that even though God has a plan for our lives, that the enemy of our soul, the devil, He also has a plan for our lives and for the lives of our children and our brothers and sisters and our neighbors, our co-workers, our family. But you see, He has a design that I call the destructive design of the devil. And I see that in this particular story of the prodigal son. And one of the reasons I see it so clearly is because the The prodigal son story is my story. I know all about leaving the father's love. I know all about going out and trying to do it my way. I know all about finding myself out in the hog pen of life. Coming to the place where I thought there's got to be a better way to live than this. Amen. But I want to just give you some of these points from the scripture. If you want to just follow along in your Bible, that'll be good. But here's the way the devil's design begins to work in a person's life. It begins with the son's disillusionment with the father. You know, you can just see that, can't you, in that story? That all of a sudden, this young man says, I'm not sure that I'm happy or satisfied being in the father's house. I'm not sure that this is the way I want to continue to live my life. And I'm here to tell you that that's exactly what the devil put in my mind when I was 14 or 15 years old. And I made a decision to walk away from the church. Even though, like Aaron, when you lived at my house, on Sunday morning you went to church. You also went Sunday night, and you went Wednesday night to prayer meeting. And if there was a revival that lasted a week or 5 weeks, we went to church every night. But even though I walked away from God, I still had to go to church. So I understand this whole process of becoming a little disillusioned in your heart. And so then, the Word of God tells us in verse 13, not long after, he got together all he had and he set off for a distant country. And I want to tell you that that's another design that the devil has. Because he wants to put distance between us and God.
Amen.
He wants to put distance between your children and God. He wants to put distance between your children and the church.
Yes.
He wants to take them to a distant destination, away from the Father's love. And that's exactly what happened in this young man's life. He set off for a distant country. But then I want to point out something else. He began to live a deviant lifestyle. Notice what it says in verse 13b. There, he squandered his living, or his wealth, in wild living. See, that's another way that the devil gets us further and further away from the Father's love. He wants us to deviate, yes, from the things that our parents taught us. He wants us to deviate from the things that our preacher has preached. He wants us just to step off of the straight and narrow. And what he'll do, he'll whisper in your ear. Now, you know, this isn't really all that bad. This isn't really all that bad. You know, your mom and dad taught you this. Your preacher preached about this. But this isn't really all that bad. And so oftentimes, and you all know this, our kids, they grow up, they graduate from high school. They go away to college. Or they get a job. They go into the military. And they're going to be facing peer pressure of people who will try to pull them to live a deviant lifestyle in contrast to the one that they were raised to live. How many of you know that I'm preaching truth?
Amen. Amen.
If you believe it, say amen.
Amen.
Say it again.
Amen.
Make me believe it.
Amen.
Amen. The devil wants to take us to a distant country as far as he can away from God.
Right.
And he wants to get us to live a deviant lifestyle. And then I want you to notice that when a person begins to do that long enough, often it leads to a destitute life. Did you hear what I said?
Amen.
Yes, come on.
Did you hear Aaron's testimony?
Amen.
Did you hear the destitution? Did you hear the spiritual deprivation? Did you hear the cry of his heart as he was crying out, God, there's got to be a better way to live. God, I want to live for you. This life is not bringing purpose or happiness or fulfillment. A destitute life is where the devil wants to take us. After he spent everything, there was a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in need. Because when the devil can get us out of the Father's house and farther away from God's Word and get us into a deviant lifestyle, it might take some people a little longer than others. Sometimes people get there rather quickly, but there'll come a point of spiritual destitution. You'll be so sick and tired of what this world has to offer. But you see, that's really a good thing. It can be the beginning of a good thing. But there's one more step before we get to the point that we look up, and it's a degenerate life. Did you hear what I said? It's a degenerate life. He went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him into his field to feed pigs. And he longed to fill his stomach with the food that the pigs were eating. Here's what I know for sure. This happened in my life. This happened in the lives of a lot of my friends. That when you begin to live that deviant lifestyle away from the clear teaching of the Word of God, and the way that you may have been raised in the life of the church, it's not very long until your life will become degenerate. You'll find yourself doing things that you never dreamed that you would ever do. You'll find yourself engaging in behavior that you swore that you would never become involved in.
Amen.
Because the devil just takes you deeper and deeper and deeper. When I left home at 17, graduated from high school when I was 17, and went to North Dakota and worked on a big farm all summer, came home and joined the Navy when I was still 17. And I remember that I was stationed in Japan almost 2 years of my final couple years in the Navy. And basically what we did is go to work and drink. That's what we did. We went to work and we drank. And I can remember many times when I would come in at night and I would fall into my rack and I would still have enough presence of mind, and maybe I'd be laying there in that room and be spinning around, and I could still remember saying, I wonder what my mother would think if she could see me now.
Right.
Yeah. I wonder what my mother would think if she could see me now. One of the guys that I ran around with, his name was Ronnie. Ronnie's dad was a pastor. And so I know that Ronnie came from a good Christian home. But I'm here to tell you, in that 2 years that we were there, Ronnie became an alcoholic. It's not that he liked to drink. He got to the point that he had to drink. It's just amazing. If I told you some of the things that I've seen him do, some of you wouldn't believe it. But you see, that's the design of the devil, to lead us into a degenerate life, doing things that we swore that we would never, ever do. Now, when I was a kid, there was a little girl that I went to Sunday school with. Her name was Linda Sue. Linda Sue was a little blonde, blue-eyed girl. And I was at that stage that I hated girls. And my dad teased me about Linda Sue. Not only did I go to school with her, I went to church with her. And my dad teased me about Linda Sue to the point that I couldn't stand Linda Sue. But then I grew up. And Linda Sue's this little blonde-haired, blue-eyed cheerleader. She's just got this vivacious personality. And now Linda Sue's looking a little different to me. And so I decided one time I'm gonna ask her out. You know, I took her out. I remember I kissed her goodnight, but my dad had ruined me. It was like kissing my sister. I never asked Linda Sue out again. He ruined me. On Linda Sue. But then I got saved October 20th, 1968, after I'd been home. In fact, my testimony is I was sitting in a bar in my hometown, New Year's Eve, 1967. I remember it was a cold, snowy night, and there just weren't a lot of people out on New Year's Eve that night. I was aggravated, thinking, well, these people don't really want to party. I mean, let a little thing like snow and ice keep them in. But I'm sitting there drinking, having a philosophical conversation with myself. Where's your life going? Are you happy? Does your life have meaning? Does it have purpose? And I looked around, and all the people that I knew in that bar, I didn't know them all, but the ones I knew had problems in their life. And I sat there at that bar that night, and I made a decision. I need to get back to God. And you know what? 10 months later, I did, in a revival at my home church. October 20th, 1968, I gave my life to Jesus, and He totally, radically saved me and turned me around.
Amen.
That's what the Lord is able to do.
Right.
And I'm sure a lot of that has to do with the prayers of my mom and the prayers of the church. And so, I almost immediately was called to preach. I got saved October 20th, 1968. I preached my first sermon April of 69. I took my first church November of 69. I didn't know a thing about pastoring. I only knew that God had called me and I was going to be obedient to the Lord. I was dumber than a coal bucket when it comes to knowing how to pastor. But I knew God had called me, and I dug into the Word of God, and I preached Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. And then I came and pastored my home church. And I pastored my home church for 6 years. And one Sunday morning, a man by the name of Milton Long, who was one of my elders, I'd grown up watching this man's life. He happened to be the uncle of Linda Sue. And he told me that particular morning, as we took prayer requests before we prayed, he said, "I'd like for all of you to pray for Linda Sue. She's in the hospital up in Columbus, Ohio." He didn't give any details. And so after the service, I said to Milton, "Milton, tell me, where is Linda Sue?" And he said, "Well, she's in the university hospital up in Columbus." I thought, well, hell, I haven't seen this woman for a long, long time. I'm gonna go up and see her. I drove up to the university hospital, and when I got there, they said, "Well, she's on the psych ward." I remember walking up to that psych ward, and I walked through those doors that they had to unlock to let me in. I saw this girl coming toward me. She still had blonde hair and blue eyes, but she wasn't the vivacious little gal that I knew. She was absolutely broken. And I came to realize that she'd gotten into a bad marriage and gotten involved with drinking and drugs. And God took Linda Sue out of the Little Bethel Chapel Christian Union Church, where she heard the Word of God proclaimed, out to live a degenerate lifestyle, and brought wreck and ruin. Are you listening to me?
No.
The devil has a design, yes, that is destructive.
Right.
And this girl had been in that degenerate lifestyle that wrecked and ruined her life. And I wish I had the rest of the story to tell you, that Linda Sue got saved and turned around, and I don't know to this very day whatever happened to her. Because I left that part of the country. And I don't know. But here's where the church can come in. And here's where the church can make a difference. Because I want you to notice that there was a change in this young man's life. I want you to notice that in verse 17 it says, when he came to his senses.
Amen.
Are you listening to me?
Amen.
When he came to his senses.
Yes.
When he came to his senses.
Yes.
Because I want you to know that the devil wants to take people into a degenerate lifestyle where they lose all common sense, yes, about how they ought to live their life. Amen.
Yes.
But the Word of God says he came to his senses.
Yes.
Here's, I remember after I made the decision that I wasn't going to serve the Lord anymore. I remember when I was 15 or 16, we were having a revival meeting, and the preacher had preached and the invitation had been given. I sat on the back row. I remember out on a pair of gray dress pants. The reason I remember it so clearly is because my mom, when the invitation was given, she walked down that aisle, and she put her hand on my shoulder. And I remember my mother standing over me and pleading for me to come to the altar and give my life back to the Lord. And I remember her tears falling down on those gray dress pants. And I was looking down, I could see her tears turning to gray, more gray than they really were. And in the hardness of my heart, I sat there and said to myself, you can make me go to church, but you cannot make me serve God. But my mom never gave up. And she kept praying, and my dad kept praying, and the church kept praying. And they were all there to rejoice when I finally came to my senses and came back to the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Well, here's what I had as a kid growing up. The little church, Bethel Chapel Christian Union Church. Am I preaching too long?
No.
Raise your hand if you want me to stop, and I'll see if we have a majority vote. Grew up in a revivalist tradition. We had revivals every spring and every fall. Sometimes for a week, sometimes for 2 weeks. And if there were people still coming to the altar at the end of the designated time, then we would go on for maybe another week. And sometimes those revivals stretched into 5 weeks. And sometimes there would be people at the altar being saved night after night after night. But I want to tell you what happened prior to that. When we announced the revival, the preacher would always preach to the church. He would always preach to the church about having a burden for the lost. Do you care about the lost? Are you concerned about the lost? Are you praying for the lost? Are you witnessing to the lost? And then at the end of that sermon, I've seen it time and time again. It's indelible in my mind. He would call the whole church forward and they would gather around the altar, sometimes 2 or 3 deep, and they would pray a united prayer at the end of the service, asking God to bring in their loved ones who were backslidden and lost. Are you with me? Listen to me. I grew up watching puddles of tears on the altar. Did you hear what I said? I said puddles of tears on the altar. When's the last time you've seen puddles of tears on the altar in your church? When's the last time we've seen puddles of tears at the altar here at St. Luke's? When's the last time people began to cry out to God from the depths of their heart, oh God, would you bring our prodigal sons and daughters home? And as we talked about this in our prayer group with the pastors, we've talked about the fact, wouldn't it be great if every prodigal son and daughter in every church in Kokomo would come home to the Father? Amen. Amen. Can you imagine the rejoicing? Can you imagine the revival? Can you imagine how God would move across this city if the prodigal sons and daughters would come home? Well, here's one of the ways that you need to pray. You need to get that prayer list that Logan talked about. You need to put those people's names on the list. And you need to bombard the, listen, you need to bombard the throne of God with those names every day.
Amen.
You need to lift them before the throne. Someone said we need to have tact with people and contact with God. Amen? We need to have tact with people and contact with God. And sometimes all we can do for our lost loved ones is to take them before the throne of grace because they won't listen to us anymore. But here's what I've taught my people to pray over the years. You pray, oh God, when Bill or Sue or George or Mary, when they're on their bed at night, and they're lying all alone in the darkness. And they don't have to have on a facade. They don't have to have any kind of defenses. When they're all alone at night, lying on their bed in the darkness with just their thoughts. Break in, oh God, break in.
Amen.
Break through, oh God, break through.
Amen.
Speak to their heart. Bring back the remembrance of the things they've heard. You put a hunger in their heart to come back to you. And I'm here to tell you, just like Aaron's testimony, God can put a hunger in your heart that no matter how far you go away from Him, all you want to do is get back to the Father's house. Amen.
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 Well, I'm almost finished, but not quite. Not only did he come to his senses and have a desire to live a different life, but he made a decision to go home to the Father.
Yes.
Let me read this to you. He said, I'm going to say to my Father, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired servants. No longer had he said that, and it said he got up and went to the Father.
Yes.
He had a desire, but he put legs on his desire. He made a decision to go home. Amen. And then when the Father sees him, he sees him a long way off. He comes running. He puts his arms around him. He is a father filled with compassion and devotion and love. And he kisses him on the cheek. Wow. Wow. This is my son who was dead and is alive.
Amen.
This is my son who was lost and is found. I want you to notice a little thing about that scripture. You see, the son, what did the son say was going to do? He said, I'm going to say, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired slaves. But you know what? The father only let him say two of those.
That's right.
He said, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. The father's saying, yep, I know. He said, Father, I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. The father said, yep, I know. But he didn't let him say, make me as one of your hired servants.
Amen.
That's when the father broke in and said, bring the fatted calf and kill it. Put a robe around his shoulders.
Amen.
Put a ring on his finger. Put shoes on his feet.
Amen.
This is my boy. He's never going to be a slave. This is my boy who has come home to the Father's love. He will never be a slave. He is my boy, and I love him. Amen. And amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Okay.
Amen.
I just want to point this out to you. We all know that in that parable that the father is God.
Amen.
Prodigal son are all those folks who drifted away. You know who the older boy is, don't you? He's the church.
Yes. Come on.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Yeah. He's the church. He is the church. He wasn't too happy that the boy came home. In fact, he's not even willing to claim him as his brother. In fact, he says to his father, this son of yours, this son of yours who went away and wasted all this money on the prostitutes, this son of yours. But I want you to notice at the end of the book, or at the end of the chapter, that the father gently reminds him, this brother of yours has come home.
Amen.
He was dead and is alive.
Right.
He was lost and is found.
Amen.
The message is to the church, folks.
Amen.
We can't be like the older brother.
Amen. Help us, Father.
We dare not be like the older brother.
Come on.
Amen.
We've got to care when our brothers and sisters are lost.
That's right.
We've got to be burdened about their lostness. We've got to bombard the gates of heaven in prayer. And ask God to work and put a hunger in their heart and bring that compelling Holy Spirit to draw them home to Himself. Amen.
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 Amen. Well, we're going to stand and sing. And there's a twofold thrust to this invitation. I wonder if there's a backslider here tonight. And you need to come home to the Father. As we stand and sing, would you come home to the Father? You come right on down and pray. He's waiting there with open arms.
Amen.
He wants to welcome you home. And the other thrust is to the church. There may be some folks here who need to come and pray and say, oh God, light the fire in my heart again.
Yeah. Amen.
Help me to put tears on the altar.
Oh, God.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's listen to the voice of God as we stand and sing.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, I'm coming home.
Come here that has a heart for the lost, inside or outside of the church, just quite simply to come down and to put puddles of tears on this altar right here tonight, right now.
You want to come here and pray tonight, even before you go home. But God needs to work in our hearts, the church tonight, to give us wet eyes over people's souls. I know that. We're going to invite you to go on back for the fellowship. If you're ready to go, you go on back and get ready. Is that okay, Brother John? Praise the Lord for His word. Let's pray. Father, we thank You tonight, Lord, for what You are doing. Because, Lord, we do not close this service tonight, Father. You have more that You are wanting to do in some of our hearts. And so we give that to You tonight, Father. Continue to work in our hearts, Lord, and stir our souls tonight within us, Lord God. Give us, Father, truly the burden for the loss that we ought to have. And help us not to be like the prodigal son's brother in any regard whatsoever. But break our hearts over the lostness of men and women's souls. And Father, we pray that even as we leave this place tonight, Father, that we will constantly be reminded of the need for the church to pray and to hold on to God for those that are lost, Lord. And so we give our time of fellowship to You. The refreshments have been prepared and everything that goes on yet tonight, Father. God, we want You to be honored. We want You to be glorified. And we pray these things in the matchless name of Jesus, our Savior. And again, I just want to remind you, you pray as long as you want to pray. Okay? You keep praying. And if you haven't got the burden yet and you need to pray longer for the burden, great. And I don't know what else to say, and if anybody else has anything, but Brother John, are you free? You've done your part. Praise the Lord. God bless you, and thank you for coming.